Hey everybody, welcome to Lifehacker for May 21st. With me is Adam Dachis.
Hello.
Woodson Gordon.
Hello.
We're going to be joined in a bit by Thorin Klazowski, and I am Adam Pash. We've got some news, we've got downloads, we've got questions, so without further ado, let's get started. All right, so in the Google sphere this week, Google announced that they're launching something they're calling the Knowledge Graph in search results. And essentially, the Knowledge Graph is it's a new feature in the side of results that if I search Frank Lloyd Wright, I will get, you know, like a little bit of info about Frank Lloyd Wright and then some related information like, say, pictures of architecture, of homes, of buildings that were designed by Frank Lloyd Wright. And it's a smart, the social graph is intended basically to give you, what was it, something instead of strings, but it's basically...
Things instead of strings.
So it's search...
Like, it's like a search by association?
Well, you search for something and it gives you back like that thing. You know,
it's things that it knows what you're searching for. Like it knows who Frank Lloyd Wright is, instead of just giving you pages that have come up with the algorithm for those three words. It knows who that is, and it's going to give you images and like a Wikipedia page or something, information on who I'm, that person.
It's sort of like an evolved one box. So the one box, you know, would give you sort of the answer to the question you were asking. But in this case, it's sort of off to the side, a more rich response of, so if you search for a person, maybe then a bio of that person, but also like it would know that if I search Frank Lloyd Wright, it's going to show me architecture. If I search Ernest Hemingway, it will maybe show me like books. And so it's a smart thing that sort of tries to create a little knowledge graph, if you will, in the side. And I don't really know. It's not rolled out yet. It's supposed to be rolling out in the next couple of days.
I think it's rolling out pretty slowly.
Well, it'll probably be rolled out by the time people are seeing this or listening to this.
Some of you may have it right now if you're lucky. None of us do.
We don't have it yet.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be coming soon. We're very excited. As of last week, it was supposed to be a few days, but who knows?
My favorite part is that they're finally doing something with that white space on the side.
Yeah, well, and it's where they had put their search plus your world stuff. I think it looked like it still might be below that, which is like it's useless. But anyway, it's a cool new feature, and I'm looking forward to getting it. DuckDuckGo has something similar that always kind of I had a tough time getting on board with. But
it was never really, it didn't give you a ton of information, but it was handy.
It seems like this is one of the first features they've added in a while that's actually something people want.
Yeah, about pimping Google Plus.
Yeah, I mean, like, well, it felt like Google was getting a lot of feature bloat, and it was kind of, I was kind of wondering, like, what is the, why add all this stuff, you know, I mean,
does
anyone really want all, oh God, I hate that.
Ugh.
Terrible.
Oh yeah, that actually would probably take the.
That's where that white space is. Instant previews will probably just show over that when you click on them.
I need to disable that.
But still, like,
I need
it's things that people don't want, and it's nice to see them putting something in.
Well, the worst part is when it just shows up when you do, like. It's fine, like, if you want it.
Accidentally.
If I'm gonna go to a page, like, I'm not gonna preview it first. I'm gonna click it.
I don't use that.
The only reason I use it is because that's where the cached link is now.
Oh,
it's buried in the preview.
It's buried in the preview, and it took me like months to figure that out until a reader told me. Thanks, reader.
Moving on, Parian, a plugin for OS X that would basically, you would install it and it would add playback support in QuickTime for virtually any file type.
It's like a codec pack for Mac, kind of.
Yeah.
Except not crappy.
It's slated for retirement.
They're going to bring out their last version, I think, in a few days or a few weeks, and then they are done developing it. It is open source, so who knows? Someone may pick it up. I hadn't really been using Parian for a while. I kind of finally migrated over to VLC because Parian never really had great MKV support for me.
But it was still a nostalgic thing. It just has to buffer.
Yeah.
Oh, no. It actually would give me an error that said it couldn't play the file.
Oh, seriously?
In most situations. And I don't know why. But at any rate, it was still like nostalgic for me, and it kind of got us thinking about other apps and services that we really, really loved but ended up going the way of the dodo. And so we put together a post of our, like, 15 different apps and services that kind of bit the dust in the recent past decade or so. Yeah. I mean, most of them died, like, in the past year or two.
Yeah.
But, or, you know, some of them took a long time to die, like Google Wave, which like first it went read only, and then it went, you know, and all
Waves
these
did
things.
Take a really long time, and they but a lot pushed of these it did. Back. They
I remember we were looking up the dates for each, and it was we had a hard time figuring out which date each one technically died, because it was when a lot of them, like Gizmo 5, would be like, current users can keep using it for a while, but no new users, and then eventually we're going to get rid of it.
I think it's better if they just rip off the Band-Aid, honestly. Like, a lot of the slow deaths, it makes you think, like, oh, maybe it will still... That we'll still have it.
Yeah, well, Waves took forever.
I know. But the problem with a lot of these is that a lot of these services, like Lala is a really good example, is that they were bought out by a company like Apple.
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, this service was really great, and then this company bought it and turned it into something really crappy.
Yeah. Like iTunes. Well, that's why everyone's scared about Posters and Instagram.
Oh, you mean Facebook? Oh, yeah, because Facebook bought them? Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see. But Facebook has come out and said, like, we're not going to...
Yeah,
absorb them and like get rid of the service. The service is going to stay on its own. But yeah, that's why I'm always afraid of people acquiring things now. Is because you take a great service and then they just junk it and use like you know maybe they're just acquiring it for the staff or maybe they're just acquiring it for like the general idea behind it. But then they're going to butcher it. You know.
Well, as Gizmodo pointed out on Monday, I think Monday, and everyone else has pointed out for years, Flickr. I mean, Flickr still exists, but when Yahoo bought it, it just nothing happened.
Yeah, Flickr is like. Was sort of as good as dead type of a situation, but that they just kept on life support, just like a slow pulse. But it was really sad.
I still use it. I still think it's the best.
A lot of people still use it.
You know what? Actually, so and that was written by Matt Honan, and it was a really really good article. He mentioned something in it that was absolutely true of me, which is like he was going and looking through his friends on Flickr's feeds, and most of them. Looked like a bunch of squares that were like automatically imported from Instagram, which is exactly what mine looks like. That's the only things that are posting to it are things that are just automatically going there from somewhere else.
Dotches is my only friend on Flickr.
I might be the only one who actually still posts photos to it.
Flickr to me looks like it's supposed to because it's just Adam Dotches.
It's my second backup. The photos go into Dropbox and they go into Flickr, and then I post them on Facebook reluctantly because people want that.
But go check that out. It's a fun little post, and there we had a few at the end that were things that almost went under and stayed alive, like X marks.
Yeah,
thank God that one.
Well, I think the important thing I'm hitting the table. I think the post points to something really important though, and that's that in the event that first of all, a lot of things that have gone under or almost went under were saved by some other developers, which is cool. I mean, you even had a project. Belvedere was picked up by someone else, right?
Yeah. Yep.
But then all the things that died, other things have come about, and I think people freak out a lot about products going away, and it's like, this is going to be gone forever, and now it's, you know, but someone comes up and fills the gap, and so I think people shouldn't worry too much about, like, Parian going away or anything else going away, because they're going to be... I mean, they're going to be, you know, there'll be something else eventually.
And we have put the alternatives to each of those apps that have died in the post, so go check that out. In most cases, they've been almost fully replaced. Mm-hmm. In a few cases, they haven't, but for the most part, you'll be able to find something that fills the need, fills the gap that it left.
Cool. All right, so last week, Thorin... did something really awesome with a balloon and a camera.
And that's all we're going to tell you.
And he's going to tell us a little bit about it now.
Hey, thanks, guys. So last week I had the pleasure of doing some balloon mapping, which is essentially taking a gigantic balloon, filling it with helium, attaching a camera to it, and then launching it out into the sky. And the purpose of this is to get nice, big, high-resolution images of any environment. In my case, I chose my neighborhood because I've always kind of wanted to see what my neighborhood looked like from above, and you know, Google Earth and Google Maps just doesn't provide that high resolution of an image to really see, and it's kind of outdated anyway. And so this was a way to see that view, see it updated in real time, and just get a really good idea of what my neighborhood really looked like. And so you launch the balloon, reel it back in, and then you start stitching all the images that your camera takes together with a free web app called MapKnitter. And it's a long and tedious process to get it all right, but it's incredibly simple to use. The whole process is really easy. It costs about $140 total, including the helium, but $100 of your materials are totally reusable forever, for the most part. And while I was doing this, I realized that there's a ton of different applications for this. It's been used in things like the BP oil spill. It's used for scientific research all the time. But for the everyman, it's a really cool way to take pictures of, say, a garden party or a graduation or, you know, an outdoor wedding. And you get these nice overhead shots that you just won't see anywhere else, and they're really neat to see. And so you can find the full post with a full guide and walkthrough on how to do it, a video of what it looks like when it's happening over on the site. And thanks so much, guys.
All right, thanks, Thorin. Now we're going to jump into the questions. Okay, our first question comes from a caller.
I have a laptop that I use mostly for Microsoft Office applications, web browsing, email. But I'm going back to school this fall, and I have thought about getting a tablet of some kind for things like note-taking and maybe e-textbooks. But I really don't want to lose my laptop's capability for working with documents, multitasking, and so on. So I'd like to hear what you think about the relative strengths and weaknesses in this situation anyway. And are there any best-of-both-worlds solutions?
Well, we've written a few things about this before. There are some really great things about tablets when it comes to productivity. They're instant on. Like, no SSD will ever match how fast you can turn on a tablet. You know, if you have a Bluetooth keyboard, you can just start typing, and you know, it has all the keyboard shortcuts built in and stuff like that. So it's possible. It really depends on what you're doing with it, I think. I don't think I could really make the full switch and not have a laptop and just use a tablet.
Mm-hmm.
But partially that's because what I have to do for my job, you know, I have to edit images and you know, I need Flash to upload things, and like that wouldn't fly with an iPad, for example.
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
Well, the caller, he's talking about taking notes and writing papers for school. Mm-hmm. So that seems like a reasonable thing. I think if you have a tablet like the Asus Transformer, that works really well.
Yes.
For that. I mean, that keyboard's actually pretty good despite being a little small. If you're using an iPad, though, like, you have to get a good keyboard case. A lot of the keyboard cases are misleading. They look like they're fine, but the keys are cramped. They put the arrow keys in weird spots.
Mm-hmm.
I think it really helps to look at a well-reviewed one. The clam cases tended to be on the higher end of stuff, but like the Zag case, for example, that keyboard isn't so great. And like, some of them are really rubbery too. I've had a lot of bad experience with those, and I don't think any of them are that great. Like, it would be nice. You want like an Apple keyboard.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, that's
don't buy a keyboard you can't try yourself.
Okay, mm-hmm. Let me offer this as an idea. Okay, so first of all, if you're just talking about taking notes and writing papers,
mm-hmm.
definitely it's doable. The one thing about like writing papers that might be sort of a catch is that if you're doing research, it's going to be more difficult.
Yeah,
you can do research. You could like switch over to Safari, Google something,
but without being able to have those windows.
But you're not going to get like the same like multitasking abilities with like side by side windows and whatnot. But anyway, let's say for the sake of argument that you do choose to go with the tablet route, and you don't need that sort of like side by side research capability. You're just someone who wants to like write, and then you can maybe go to a computer and beef it up later. I would actually recommend, potentially, if that's sort of your idea for both note taking and paper writing, you could just use your iPhone or your Android. I mean, any phone. Hook up the Bluetooth keyboard to it, like the Apple keyboard, Bluetooth keyboard, which you can connect to your phone, which I've done, works really well. And then just like sit your phone down and type. And then all you've really got is a keyboard and your phone, which you've got with you already. Especially for note taking, that would be a piece of cake. You would just carry, you might look weird to people because you have a headless keyboard and a phone sitting next to it. They might think you're the insane student, but it would work really well for that sort of purpose. It would work just as well, basically, as a tablet for that sort of like note taking in class or whatever. And if you already have a phone, it's not going to cost you anymore.
Yeah.
So something to consider.
I didn't think about that. The last thing is, if you wait for the Windows 8 tablets, those might be more suited to something like that,
mm-hmm.
because you can get into that full desktop if you need it, and you can run the Metro app side by side. It doesn't, I mean, still isn't perfect for something like research, mm-hmm. but it would make the tablet a little bit more versatile in situations like that.
Yeah.
So maybe that's something to think about.
But I have to say, if you are going Android, the Asus Transformer.
The Asus Transformer is amazing.
It feels a lot like a netbook and a tablet. And
it's almost the perfect mix between netbook and tablet.
Yeah. especially the new one.
So our next question comes from a reader who says, I guess the reader, Uncomfortable Open Book, writes, I just did a Google search of my name, and the amount of personal information I found in the top results was extremely discomforting. There are links not only to a whole pool of my profiles on different websites, many that I don't even use often at all, but it gets as detailed as links to a video that I happen to favorite on Vimeo, or the profile of a random friend of mine who followed me on Pinterest. This is way too much to be able to access by a simple search of my name. What's the best way to make my search results relevant to me? Okay, so there are a lot of ways you can approach this problem. At the end of the day, Google is just going to index whatever there is on the internet associated to your name. That's Google's job. And so one of the first things you can do off the bat, which we recommend countless times, is to make a nameplate site for yourself. Something that basically is you. It's going to be your iHaveAdamPash.com, you know, something like that. That's like so easy, so like obviously you. Google will almost always recognize those and put it at the top of your results. And you can also do things like link that profile in your Twitter account or like your whatever, in places where it'll sort of identify this as this person. Obviously, though, that doesn't do a ton. That basically just controls the first result. Luckily, that's what most people are looking for anyway. Mm. However, if you, for the rest of the results, again, it's a matter of what's available about you. So, one thing you can do is try and make the relevant results for your name more what you want them to be, which basically means you need to create more stuff.
Yeah.
that's going to take their place. Obviously, that sort of is, again, it's sort of Google's going to decide what's more relevant, but you can help it by, for example, on your nameplate site, linking to the things about you that you want to be associated with you. Google's smart. It uses those sorts of cues to rank its results. But then the last thing is basically, if you don't want something to show up in Google results for your name, so you just need to not associate those things with your name, because at the end of the day, that's always going to be there somewhere, even if it's not on the first page, on the third page or the fourth page. If you have your Vimeo account associated with your name, it's going to show up when you do things in Vimeo. So you can just, you want basically to come up with a screen name of some sort and don't use your real name. And that's really the only way that you're going to like stop associating some of those things.
I actually did this recently. There was just so much random junk coming up when under my name. It's like, you know, Last.fm and, mm-hmm. and YouTube and stuff like mm-hmm. that. And there are certain things that I don't mind, but there's certain things that's just like, get that junk out of there. And it already had a screen name. You just go in and I just took my name out of the name box and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
It's really simple to do if you just have too much of that junk. Get rid of it.
The trade-off, of course, is that like your friends might not find you as easily, but you know.
But the thing is, it still is really easy because you're either friends with them on the site or like I still link to it on my Facebook.
Well, no, I don't mean necessarily via search, but like when they first join, like, you know, if I go to Facebook, I search Witz and Gordon and there you are. But that seems like a pretty minor trade-off if like that's your big goal.
Absolutely.
So yeah. Do what you... Oh, and also, actually, just a quick side note. Last week, Twitter just released a new feature that allowed you to take and basically like a no search... Well, I don't remember what that... But do not track so that your tweets and whatnot aren't tracked by Google. Small thing, but if Twitter is one of those things, you can actually keep your name associated with it and turn off the tracking so that it's not included. It's not a lot of services give you that option, so it's not the most practical all the time. Okay, so our next question comes from reader Dylan, who writes, I manage files for a small site that sells music. I'm looking for a solution for taking high-quality audio source files like FLAC or ALAC.
Apple's lossless.
And transcoding them into common formats like MP3, M4A, and AUG. Preferably, this could be done in one, quote, easy step, perhaps with some configuration and drop folders, maintaining file naming and tags where applicable. Is there a good solution for this?
Yeah. We have a couple of things between us. The one thing that I discovered recently was WAPWolf, which is a web app for web apps, kind of. you connect it to your Google Drive or Dropbox, and I think they're adding it to box.net soon, and you can make a drop folder where you drop in something, and then you tell Wapwolf, this is what I want to do with certain kinds of files that go in. In this case, you can put in whatever source audio file you want that's supported, but the list is a lot of supported files. And then it will take that and convert it to some other format or multiple formats, whatever you want it to do. You just tell it what you want, drop it in, and then it will add the new ones in. So that's a really easy way to go about this. Alternatively, on OS X and Windows, there's an app I really like called Adapter that converts video, downloads YouTube videos, but also has a great audio conversion option, and you can just batch convert stuff very easily. It's not, I don't think it does a drop folder thing, but you can just kind of drag and drop it in and set it to go, use presets or whatever, and then you're done. But Whitson, you have
another use something option. Different. There's generally within the audio converting community, it's a weird community, but there are two really big apps for audio conversion, and on Mac it's XLD, and on Windows it's DB PowerAmp. DB PowerAmp is great. I'd probably recommend Adapter over it just because Adapter is a little bit easier to use. It's free, right?
Yeah.
Whereas DB PowerAmp, there is a free version, but you know, all the good stuff, like being able to use multiple cores and convert stuff faster, is a pro feature. XLD on the Mac is fantastic, though, because you go into the preferences, set the kind of file types and audio quality settings and stuff like that, and then it just doesn't have an interface. You drag your files to the doc icon, and it throws them into whatever folder you tell it to throw in the preferences.
That's nice.
So it's it's the app that everybody uses to convert audio. So it's great if you're converting things to the same file types all the time. You just open up XLD, drag it to the doc icon, and you're done. But if you're going to be changing settings kind of for each conversion, Adapter might be a better option.
Or if you need multiple formats.
Cool. All right, so last is a follow-up from a question someone asked us last week. Bob writes in with an update for the guy who couldn't get Google to accept payments through the Play Store. Bob says, there was a question on last week's episode about credit card payments through Google Play being rejected. I had the same problem and found the cause was I was using a rooted Nook color, and Google would not add this device to my Google account because it was not approved, and only approved devices could download paid apps. The only error I saw was there's a problem with your payment. I could download all three apps I wanted. I have heard about this happening with other non-rooted devices, which Google had not yet added to the devices, the list of approved devices. Google would be better served to have a no refund policy for unapproved devices. And actually, I feel like I've seen people talk about this before, where they've rooted a device, or like actually sometimes like something like the Playbook or whatever, when they install Android.
Yeah,
on it,
or when you
like
install Android on the Nook, like Alan did earlier this year.
And so it's a device that basically the Google Play Store is saying, like, this isn't even
an Android device. What are you doing?
Here. We're not going to take. We won't take your money, which of course is silly. And so thank you, Bob. So that's it for the questions this week. Let's move on to the downloads. Okay, our first download is Autodesk 123D, and basically it's a free Windows program that lets you create a 3D model of some sort if you want. But if you've ever wanted to try 3D printing, but you don't want to shell out however many thousand it is for a MakerBot, you can use this application to create your little 3D project and then upload it to their servers, and they can send you a quote for various 3D printers that will print the object and send it back to you. So it's a pretty cool option if 3D printing is something you've always wanted to try.
Firefox released a new beta for Android devices. It's basically a completely revamped browser. It's way faster than the old one. The interface is completely native, looks much more Android-like, and it's just added a few new features that make it, Flash support, things like that. If you were using Firefox before but you didn't like it because it was so incredibly slow, check it out again. You got Firefox Sync, everything that makes Firefox great on the desktop, on Android, and super fast. Sparrow, our new favorite mail client for iOS, came out with a minor update this week with just a few little convenience features. You can now create labels right from the app, which is pretty handy. You can swipe between messages, just scroll to the bottom or the top of a message, and it will move to the next one in your inbox. And lastly, you can compose messages in landscape mode, which is really nice if you don't really type that fast in portrait mode. No push notifications yet, but they should be coming soon.
For the Mac, we have Proper Volume, which adds better volume controls to your Mac's menu bar. You may be used to the current volume controls where it's just a slider that adjusts the speakers or the headphones or whatever you have plugged in. But if you want a little bit more control, install Proper Volume. It puts a nice little black speech bubble heads-up display thing when you click on it, and you can adjust the input. You can get volume levels and you can of that input and also the output and switch sources. So it's a really handy tool, great upgrade for the current volume options.
All right, and that is it for this week. We will see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.
If you'd like to ask us a question, send us an email at tips plus asklhshow@lifehacker.com. Alternatively, leave us a message at 347-687-8109. Try to keep your questions to about 30 seconds so we can keep the show moving. And thanks for watching, listening, or however you're getting this podcast from the internet to your brain.
Welcome to Lifehacker for the week of May 14th. With me is Adam Dodges.
It's actually the 21st.
What?
Every time I'm like...